Martin is gonna be next here, Martin Perker. And one of the things that AI can do a lot with us is helping us with preventing us to make mistakes. I talked about this in my keynote about allow people to write things wrong and they can actually, the machine can fix it for them. So instead of asking them once again to do the same thing. When it comes to like malware, when it comes to detecting spam, then deep learning is a very, very good way of dealing with these kind of things. When it comes to moderation, things that humans should not ever see, that's something where machines can help us as well. So Martin is going to talk about data mining for security anomalies to actually go through your code or go through your logs and find the problems that occurred that humans might miss because it's just so much data, but a machine doesn't get tired, so probably we find security mistakes or security problems before they become a problem. So help us be safer. Thank you very much, Martin.
Hello. All right, thank you for the introduction. This was already a very long conference, and you're still here and you want to know something about security. That's great, because when you have data, or you have a lot of data, you have big data, you usually also have a security and privacy problem. So maybe, yeah, you can see it. It's a little bit small at the bottom of the screen. I'm from the University of Applied Sciences in St. Pölten. For those of you who don't know, St. Pölten is about westward of Vienna, 23 minutes by train. And although we are an applied university, we also have a dedicated section that does IT security research. So we not only teach IT security, we also have dedicated research projects who tackle problems in IT security. And one of these projects that are currently running is the Josef Ressel Center Target. That's the Ressel Center for Unified Threat Intelligence on Targeted Attacks. So what's this research project about? You maybe know the internet is evil. All evil comes from the internet. All the bad malware comes from the internet. And you actually shouldn't interact with the internet. You just unplug your computer. It's much more safer. Unfortunately, it does not work. The internet produces 24/7 new kind of bad software. And the question is obviously how to detect this software. What can we do about it? So there are two common strategies. Up to now, there was either we already know what the bad software is, the malware, the executable, whatever, and we identify it. So we make a checksum before you start a new program. You make a checksum of the program. And then you ask yourself, is this a good program or is this a bad program? If it's a good program, then I start it. If it's already a bad known program, then no, I don't start it. This obviously does not work, because if you have new malware, new threats, someone has to recognize this as bad software. So you need to have a database of already known malware, and you still don't know about the new software, new malware stuff. Okay. Then was the idea, well, let's make some rules. For example, all my programs are installed under program files. So if I start a program, it has to come from program files. If I start a program and or the computer starts a program from C temp and some exe file name, normally programs do not start from a temporary directory. Or they do not start from your web server directory. If someone can somehow upload through a security bug executable into a web server directory, and then an executable is started from this directory, this should not happen. So we can make rules about this. We can write a rule, never do this, never do that. I need to pay an expert for some hours. He sits down, he writes some rules. We have hundreds, 200, 300 of rules, which is normal good behavior, which is OK and which is not OK. So the problem is this is also very limited because it works only for these cases we already know. And I also it's always incomplete because I cannot predict the future. So if I have a program that makes, for example, on the 31st of December, the yearly database backup, I have to have in my rules, this program makes on the 31st of December the yearly database backup, and it's OK. Please don't raise an alarm. This is not unusual behavior. This is OK behavior. OK, so it does not scale. So this is one of the ideas that led to the target Resocentrum, where we thought, okay, when an attack is happening, an attacker must do something. He wants to do something. I said, yeah, he has to break in. He wants to look around. He wants to find some information he wants to steal, and he needs to transfer this information. So he is noisy. He does some things which are not usual normal behavior. And the idea is, if a system behaves differently and a new kind of attack is going on, I should see this in a recording of whatever the system was doing. If I record what the system does, what is actually running on the system. So the research problem is, I record everything what happens on the system, then I look automatically detect in this lots of events what is my normal baseline behavior by learning from different systems, and actually the anomalies should remain, the new behavior, what I not know about already. These are suspicious events, and if there is an attack, it should be one of these attacks. Okay, does this work? I don't know. So we tried to implement this idea in practice, and without rules and without any checksums, can we find attacks when they are going on? So actually, I have in practice, when I want to implement this, I have three problems. I have one problem of I need to get the data, what is happening on a system. The second problem is I now have a lot of data, and I have to store it, I have to manage it, I have to pre-process it somehow. And the actual problem of detecting what is the anomaly in my data is actually the third problem. How do we do that? So this is about our workflow, very basic, and it looks in practice like that. We have collectors installed on individual systems that record what is happening on the system. These events are collected into a large database. So we have a large server, and on the server we have several Docker containers running. One is the database that collects all the events incoming. Then we have our experimental code that analyzes this data stream and where we want to do this malware detection. And as an interface, you probably already know Jupyter Notebooks, Jupyter Lab, as cross-platform, easy platform to do the prototyping. It's very, very nice. You can run it on the server, and you only need on the client side the browser interface. You can do this with your regular PC. So in detail, how do you capture what is happening on your system? If you do a literature search on previous research project, to make anomaly detection, you find some previous works. So the usual student project is, I look what system calls my web browser is doing, and then I make a profile of my web browser. So if my web browser is compromised, I see that he calls different system calls. Easy. Then you find previous research projects where it is, okay, we monitor our mail server, and if our mail server behaves differently, that's an anomaly. If you want to write an event collector that really collects all things happening on the system, what process is started, what process starts another process, what files are accessed, are they read, are they write, are they delete, are they removed, what network connections, TCP, UDP, registry, etc. This is actually a lot of work. This is non-trivial. So you don't find this in open source, and those people who invest the resources to implement this usually make an antivirus project and get rich of it. So as a researcher, it's a little bit of a problem to get the data you really need. In Project Target, we have as an industry partner the local company CyberThreat, who has such an implementation of an event collector, and you really need to write kernel level module, not one, I think three, then you have to sign it, so Windows loads, etc. So you get the data. Then you have the pile of data. Then you have a real-time stream of events. If you have ever been to an operating system class at university, you know about, okay, an operating system does about that, and processes work like that, and file system accesses like that. I myself looked then at the log file of all the events what an operating system is doing. Today's computers are very, very, very fast, and they produce a lot of events, and you cannot imagine what's everything happened within a second. So you get this real-time event stream. You have to save this in a database. You want at the same time to run the analysis module on this data stream. And you want, of course, two changes to the database while you don't have any downtime with it. As a bonus point, okay, I get a cloud server and get some capacity there. Does not work because you're really recording very closely what is happening in a system. So if you go to an industry partner and say, I will want to record what's happening, the company usually says, no, please do not upload our events to the cloud. You have to do this locally on your local installation, and you cannot just go and get some cloud computing services so you get more processing power. Okay, has to work on-premise. And there's another slight problem, the European Union Data Protection Regulation. When you record what's happening on a system, you usually also record very personal data of the users, or you record user data. So you have to ask yourself the question, do you record personal data? So we also found this out a little bit later in the project. So this is, for example, a raw capture, what happens on the system. The process starts Outlook by Thomas, then Thomas starts his Chrome browser, then he writes to some file, then he makes up a connection to the website, and then he makes another connection to a Gmail. Actually, that's a very personal profile. If you want to detect malware and you want actually work for security, you have to look very closely what's happening, but you also get very close to what a user is doing. So one idea is I just hash the websites and I get I replace it with a random string. That's great because if you have the website hashed in the network connection, you cannot immediately say what was that. That's a little bit of privacy. Problem is, if two users surf to the same website, they generate the same hashes, and you can, again, trace back what the user was looking at. And if you remove the username, you remove the websites, you still have the pattern what the user is calling. So first user always in the morning starts Firefox, then he starts Outlook, then he starts Word, and the other user always starts Spotify, Edge, NetBeams, and Outlook. Even if you try to remove the user data, you all, still get a user profile and maybe see what actually that user was. So if it has a developer, he always starts the developer's tools. You know it. So you don't know privacy problems until later. So we figured this, some of this stuff out while looking to the events. And the actual problem at the end, we want to detect the malware. What can we actually detect in the stream of data? Either an attacker does something completely new, he starts new processes, or the case, the second case is that the attacker takes control of an already known process, for example, a web server, and pushes it a little bit to do something new. For example, a web server usually serves all the files from the HDDocs directory, but all of a sudden the web server scans over all the file system and accesses password files and other directories and files a web server normally does not access. I can see that in the data. So how does this look like? You see here, for example, if we have two web server processes, and imagine a load balancer where every access from an even IP address goes to one web server, and every access from an odd IP connection goes to the other web server. But they do essentially the same stuff. And here, you see the time axis on X, and you see on the y-axis file accesses, new files accessed, and it's just the length of the file name accessed, including the path. So in the beginning, you see when both start up, you see a lot of accesses, and then you only see a lot of temporary files because these are the only new files the web server uses or creates during his run. And what you, when you see an attack, you see, oh, as a human, I see, oh, something happened there. And I look there, oh yeah, someone broke in via a PHP shell. It would be nice if the reality always works like that. Okay, this is now an example of an attack. So coming via the web server to command exit, okay. But then you see web server to command exit the shell, and then start, who am I? What user account am I here? Then look at the network configuration, and then ping around, see what's running on the network. This is marked in red because usually this is not called that way. So this was obviously an attack. What is this? Again, x-axis is time, y-axis are file accesses. If you don't see it in the small print, these are 8 digits, the events is just the events counter. So this is the example of Windows Update. Windows Update runs every patch Tuesday, and then you get multiple individual updates. We as a human look immediately at this picture and see, of course, this matches here, this matches here. The same things happened. As an algorithm who has millions and millions and millions of events, it's not quite so easy to say, okay, who matches what, and does this really match there? And the reality is even more messy. The reality is like that. It looks almost the same. The file accesses are not the same. And maybe here in the middle happened something. And maybe this peak was actually the attack I'm looking for. Okay, does this work? So far, what we tried to data mine events as we record them, it's good enough. What you see here is our attempt to make this explainable to the user, so building on the explainable AI presentation before the break. How do we show the user what state the system is in? So one idea is this. You have basically the processes, 0 processes, 100 processes. You have the x-axis again, the time. And I have here in green the processes that the script says are maybe suspicious, malicious, whatever, please look at it. And then we have here in blue the processes where the algorithm said, they're probably okay, you don't have to look at it. So internally, the algorithm classifies the data as it comes in. It's not only just the two cases you see here. There are actually many cases internally where the algorithm says, this process on one side behaves exactly on all PCs the same. On the other side of the spectrum, we have processes which are completely new on the system. And in between this extrema, you have some cases in between. Okay, looks like the same process and looks like he does about the same. Or looks like it's the same process but has some additional suspicious things. So you get a spectrum. And the algorithm goes through the millions and millions of events and actually makes a recommendation to a human. I, as a human, can look at events and what's happening. I can do 100, I can do 1,000 events, I can 10,000 processes maybe when I'm very busy. But the algorithm makes a recommendation to me as a user and pre-sorts the data and says, okay, you expert, you only have a little bit of time. Please look at these unique processes first. And then you look at these suspicious processes first. And even if you have more time, you can look at the more processes. But as an operator, I want to have a nice picture where that says me, what's the state of the system? And usually it's just flat. And then you have an attacker who logs in. And all of a sudden, the percentage of suspicious processes rises from about 0 to 5%. Something happened there. I can look into it and say, okay, 5% of all processes behave strangely. I don't care. And then, after some time, the attacker, he knows this login was successful, comes back, and the percentage of processes that are suspicious rise from 5% to 20% within a short time frame. And that's the point where I say, okay, the high-level view is something really changed on the system. We didn't change anything. There was no update. The administrator didn't do anything. Now, really, a human should look at this system and what happened there and whether this is a regularity, that's okay. Unfortunately, you have to believe me, this is real data. Companies do not give away the data. They're only under NDA attack data. So this is a real attack, but I cannot show you the details. Some people would not like that. But the idea is, high level, zoom in, zoom in, zoom in, zoom in, and the algorithm pre-sorts the data and gives recommendations so the experts look at it, what's really worth to analyze. Okay, are we done? We solved the problem, right? We can go home. As a researcher, I have published a paper on this. What the company does with that, I don't care. As a security guy, and we are all developers here, the next step is, okay, I have an algorithm that about works, good enough, not perfect, we know that. Can we transition this algorithm from prototype to production? Okay, as a security guy, I need this algorithm to be resistant to deliberately fudged input data fields. Imagine if I'm recording whatever happens on the system. Usually you name your files hello world exe and test one text and test two text and copy one and new copy two and whatever. But imagine you can also give your file names really Unicode characters of all the Unicode alphabet. And then you recognize, okay, on Mac and then Linux, and it's all not the same definition on different operating systems. So if an attacker really wants to disturb your data collection algorithm, he can be really, really creative by getting what Unicode allows him to do. And your data processing model should handle it well. It should never crash. The second thing is, you want your implementation to be resistant to real-world attacks. Imagine someone takes out Metasploit and now runs every available exploit against your server, and you have your event collector, and you get all of a sudden, within a short time frame, a lot of data, and your implementation should not fall over. Hmm. Okay, for the data encoding and safety problem, I always show this when I have a big data problem where there's, okay, we have an HTTP interface, and then we have a REST-style API, and then we send the JSON document with the data from here to there. And I'm asking, okay, when you consume this JSON document, have you ever thought about to somehow check that the data in there makes sense? Because I know of this page, you can go there, 2 years ago, a guy made a test suite on JSON documents. There are 16 different programming languages and even more different JSON parsers. And if you look at this, not every implementation or parsing of JSON data does the same. So if you get your data stream in JSON data, please think about whether you are resistant to certain broken data and what your program does with it. There's a whole initiative called LangSec.org, which says, I consume input data, and with every byte, can I decide this data is not OK, I stop, or this data is OK, I continue reading the data. As an IT security guy, I really, really want to know what's coming in, so my program does not fall over. On the problem with testing the load, I'm a poor academic. I cannot go to my boss, please buy me a cluster so I can put some load onto the system and see whether it falls over. The other idea is, okay, I've used Anaconda Python, and maybe we can go smaller. Luckily, last year, someone ported this Anaconda ecosystem and also ported this Asperi Conda, made it available in the SciPy 2017 conference. And you can run it easily on an ARM-based machine. So I tried it. I took my Python-written prototype, which was written in Anaconda Python. So Anaconda Python Docker container has 3.6 gigabytes. Then you take Periconda on an ARM machine with 1.3 gigabytes. Almost all the libraries you want to use are there. And I ran it here on the ARM box, and it worked. It ran out of memory after 2 gigabytes of RAM. That's OK. But as a porting experience and as a stress test, it was very interesting to see my code is portable. And if I put more load under this box, I really see where the time is spent. It's, of course, not an ideal comparison, but I've shown this demo a guy who does sensor networks, so smart sensors in the field. And he really had a problem. OK, he wants to develop the software on a PC, and then he wants to put such a box somewhere in the field, in a small corner, in a box somewhere with power and network. And you can take the same code and run it on this small box. And in the field is the data processing, the first stage of the pre-processing, and then the pre-processed data is sent back. And he found this very, very interesting. If you want to go to such an event as here and make a booth, it's also a nice demonstration. You can put the server code, the prototype, really on the server here. The laptop is only the terminal, the input, and then you can see what do you want to search for in our data and what events does Windows Update, for example, produce. Great and portable. On the thing of secure implementation, I did another experimentation. So instead of Python, I thought, well, there's the hype about Rust, because Rust is blazingly fast, prevents sec faults, guarantees thread safety, guaranteed memory safety, great stuff, minimal random. Sounds like Christmas present. I said, OK, when I already know my algorithm, and I don't need all these libraries that are in Python available, so I have a standalone algorithm, why not implement the core in a different programming language and see how fast it gets and how less memory it uses. I tried this. The top, you see the implementation in x86, standard PC. So I ported a portion of the algorithm, not complete. So this is a learning experience. On x86, it takes about 1 minute and 7 seconds. It was limited by the database. So the Rust code was very, very fast, and the database could not stream the events fast enough. Then I said, OK, can I do this also on the Odroid, on the small box? I just recompiled the code on the ARM, and it also worked. And it's a little bit slower, almost 2 minutes. It was limited because it's only a single core implementation currently, so it was maxed out by the one ARM core on the Odroid. And if you already have this portable code, you can even push this further. Again, I compiled the code on a tablet with 2 gigabytes of RAM. Here you see it takes 4 minutes, 44 seconds. The limit was not the RAM use of the tablet. The limit was not the processing power. The limit was the Wi-Fi connection, because that maxed out, I think, 11 megabytes per second. But it works. So in theory, I could put portions of my security data analysis algorithm on a tablet, connect by a network connection. I can show the company the real sensitive data is actually done here on this device. So there are lots of possibilities how to implement this, and implementing it in Rust, the code was really more robust, because I found some corner cases which I did not see in Python because of the dynamic typing of the variables. So I'm almost out of time. Talking points from this presentation, hopefully I have shown you. If you do data mining for security and to detect malware, it is an option, and it offers new possibilities to find new malware. But of course, there's the problem. You will record personal data, and in the beginning, you probably do not know what you're actually recording. The usernames are quite clear. We also found file names that had the name of the host, the name of the computer in it, which is, of course, every time different. But sometimes companies name their PCs very interesting names, and you don't want to have that in the data. But you cannot look at millions of events and immediately know what's in there. If you consume arbitrary data from the RISC or some partner, please take a minute and think about, is this really sane, and what can there really be in there, or not just nice data fields, whether this produces buffer overflows and out of memory and other interesting things in your consumption. And if you are in one environment, be open and also look at other environments, and maybe port portions of your thing to other environments that offer benefits. So I say thank you for your attention. I'm almost on time. Feedback is always welcome, either now after these presentations, or send me an email. There are 4 URLs here, the URL of the university if you want to study IT security or data science and business analytics. On the info booth outside, there are still a few flyers I've seen, if you're German-speaking and local. Go to the homepage of the Josef Ressel Center Target homepage, where you see our activities in the center. There's the Institute for Security Research homepage. This is currently being redone. It's a little bit ugly. Come back early next year, 2019. So this will be in a few days better. And if you want to buy IT security software made in Austria from our research partner CyberDrap, that's a local Viennese company, where this will be integrated. So you can throw money at them and say, I want to buy this. Go to cyberthreat.com. Thank you for your attention. I'm very, very punctual on time, right?
Yeah, you're good. Actually, we're very good that you have the email up there because we can send you all the questions again that you don't get time to answer.
Okay.
No, there is no choice there. Basically, you have to.
Okay.
No, there is a choice, of course, but it would be nice if there's good questions there, I think.
I will answer all questions so I get Christmas presents.
Yes, exactly. Everybody's watching. Yeah, that's always the thing. Yeah, we talk about Father Christmas as something nice, but it sounds like a really bad chatbot in the background always listening in. Systems change all the time. How do you prevent accidentally learning an attack pattern as a new and valid behavior in large environments?
What is a large environment? We had the discussion already with a guy here at the conference who said, what do you do when you already know you have a lot of servers and you don't really know whether they are clear? So maybe some of them are already compromised. And then, of course, you learn the patterns of the attacker because he's already in there.
Yeah.
So now, you really want to set this up, start slow on a clear server, clean slate, run it 3 days in a not network environment, and if you baseline, then expose it, then learn something new, and then put.
So a post-mortem honor attack is very important because you get a chance to actually find out why it happened to prevent it from the next time.
Yeah, one of the things is when we report a process as suspicious, I cannot show you the log file, but the log really shows why the algorithm marked it like that. So at the end, you get a red process, but you also get then the list of file accesses. Why of this 1,000 times services exe was run, 10 times services exe was marked as suspicious because of these, and these accesses.
Okay, excellent. What algorithms would you recommend for security anomaly detection? Also, can you recommend public data sets for that detection, labeled or unlabeled?
I cannot recommend public data sets because we only get those. We create our own because you can get lots of different features, what you want to record, and we did not know what actually works. Hmm. And then we modified the collector. We want this, but we want that. And then we optimized and tried. So the three steps I've shown, you have three problems at the same time. Get the data, pre-process it, and then the algorithm. Then you have the idea. Then the idea does not work because either my program was shit or the data was shit. And then when you know, you get, okay, I create new data, new features, have a new idea, and this is an always improving cycle. So just not get public data sets, and we will work with that now.
Okay. So we heard it, the data is shit, so that's not good. So we have a break now again for another 10 minutes. If you are so inclined, we can get the questions emailed to you. If you find the time, it would be nice. If not, you're here for a few more hours so people can talk to you.
Well, they close down in 2-3 hours, right?
Yeah, but I mean, they cannot forcefully take us outside, right? If we sit down and they'll sit down and discuss the security more? No, we don't. Okay, so, but you're available. Put all the data out there, and it's thank you for this. It was an interesting one. And the next talk is going to be I need your data, so we hopefully say it's not going to be shit data. So we'll go from there. See you in 10 minutes.